All right, so what I would like to do is first show you a PowerPoint, and I want to start with something I had concluded my discussion with on Tuesday, and that is statues of Gandhi. So want to, and of course I think you'll understand why I'm doing that, because in Munnabhai Lage Raho Munnabhai, there are a number of references to the fact, as Munna or Murli sometimes says, that you know, he hears Bapu speaking to him, and Bapu says that, well, you know, the way I'm being remembered in the country is, you know, through my statues, through my name being put on all these different buildings, and my figure appearing on these currency notes, and all of this should be taken down, right? So, and of course, I think that, you know, if you're looking at sort of the visual national culture of a country, one of the ways in which one attempts to understand it is through statues. So before I venture forth into my own particular interpretation of statues, I want to pose a question to you. How do you view a statue generally? What purpose do you think a statue serves? Yes, Julia.
Normally, I think of a statue as a way to recognize someone that is held in high esteem amongst society and community.
Okay, so would you say that a statue is an aid to remembering someone that you think is worthy of remembering? I mean, ordinarily, we would not put up statues to people, whatever society we are in. So, for example, I don't think you'll find any statue to Adolf Hitler. I doubt it very much.
No,
right?
That's why I'm saying, yeah, someone that was respected.
That's right. Right. So someone that we're in agreement there, that in general, that we will put up statues to those that we think are worthy of respecting and remembering. Would there be a general agreement about that? Okay. I want to suggest to you that actually leave me out of that general agreement, but you'll see why. All right. Okay. Anubha?
I think especially statues in India, if I think about like Gandhi statues or like Shivaji and all of that, and
yeah, yes,
to communicate their allegiance to people who've been respected in the past as a way of, you know, then garnering like support.
True, absolutely. So there's a politics.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, like, you know how noble, like when you're around a temple or something,
yeah, yeah.
So we should behave ourselves. So it's also like a way of, you know.
Okay. So you're giving a little more elaborate reading here, because, for example, if, let's supposing that, you know, there was a crowd that was feeling somewhat rowdy, and they were engaging in rowdy behavior. So here, let's say a bunch of 10 men come out of a bar, they're drunk, and then, you know, oh, you know, Bapu's statue, they see Gandhi's statue there, you know, so they try to, right, control themselves a little bit, yeah, because it's a bit of a check, they feel a little guilty, perhaps. Yes, I understand, and I would agree with that sentiment. I would also agree that there are groups that attempt to politicize. In India, in recent years, it has become perfectly respectable to actually deface statues of Gandhi. Not that it's done routinely, but it has become possible to do that. It would not have been possible after the assassination of Gandhi, when statues of Gandhi started to be put up. You generally do not put up statues, by the way, to a person when they're still alive. That's generally not the practice. You only put up statues when they're dead. All right? So that would go back to the point about, you know, trying to help us to remember these figures, because once a person has, you know, gone into the other life, as it were, slowly the process of forgetting begins. And that's one reason why in the conventional explanation, statues are an aid to this memory, helps us respect, you know, the someone whom we think is worthy of our attention. As I said, I mean, obviously things have changed, because today it is perfectly acceptable in some places in India to deface a statue of Gandhi, which would have been unthinkable. There is someone whose statues you cannot deface in India. If you do so, it's an enormous risk and consequence. And that's a man by the name of B.R. Ambedkar, who is the leader of the Dalit community. He's passed away many years ago, but he's recognized as a great leader of the Dalits, or who used to be called untouchable. So Ambedkar has literally become untouchable now, actually. It's impossible to level any critique of Ambedkar and hope that you're not going to be skinned alive for doing so. And that includes defacing Ambedkar statues. I mean, once in a rare while it happens, a right-wing Hindu group might deface it in the dead of the night, but then the next day there's going to be a political disturbance. You can be quite certain about that, you know. All right. However, I clearly would not be posing this question to you unless I thought that there was something else going on when we think about statues. All right. So can you think of something else, Anya? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So no, you're on the mark. You're on spot. If you look at, for example, good illustration you've given, I think, of the debates that have taken place in the U.S. in recent months. It was only in August of last year in Charlottesville that the whole ruckus started over the statue of General Lee. We know that the right wing, the neo-Nazis, that they congregated around the statue just as there were people on the other side who wanted that statue removed and wanted other Confederate statues removed as well. So, and that might be the clearest illustration of the fact that this form of public monumentality actually has various kinds of political significations. Ordinarily, however, I would like to suggest as a corollary, ordinarily people don't really get excited by statues. That is, you put a statue there, and for the most part, the statue will excite very little attention unless it's a provocation. So, for example, these statues are now viewed as a kind of provocation. That is, the statues of Confederate soldiers and so on. But remember that this is all in the aftermath of the election of a president who has, in a way, condoned the neo-Nazis, right? And obviously, neo-Nazi groups have felt emboldened, but there was no such ruckus really 5 years ago. Or 10 years ago, there have been occasional calls every now and then, but no one ever has acted on them. Yeah? And these statues go back to 100 years. So I think that, in fact, the ruckus over it demonstrates precisely the fact that, for the most part, they are not seen as troubling or problematic. You know, for the most part, right? So, but any other further thoughts? I think you wanted to say something.
Sometimes there's a religious element to statues.
Yeah.
I imagine that's probably true with
Yes and no. Yes and no. I'm going to show you some statues of Gandhi, so we'll begin to understand. But now let me put forward a couple of propositions to take you to a very different frame of mind. And again, you don't have to go along for the ride, because this is my own particular interpretation. But I'm going to demonstrate that actually through some of the slides that I'm going to show you as well. The first and most noticeable thing about statues is that you forget who they are about. In fact, a statue is meant to make you forget that person, far from remembering him. That's my first proposition for you. Now, I can tell you that in cities where you find a prolific number of statues, And you have to go really to more to European cities. Yes, there's public statuary in all American cities, quite a lot of it. For example, if you go to downtown LA, you'll find some statues. You won't find them in the valley, in the San Fernando Valley, generally, for example. But you know, you would usually find them in the business district. So if you go to London, it's full of statues, full of statues. Partially because they had so many scoundrels of the empire, they all had to be remembered, as it were. You know, so every scoundrel of the empire who ruled over India or Nigeria or whatever, they is remembered with a statue. And the most kingly place of statues in all of London is Trafalgar Square. If anyone's been to London, you know exactly what I mean, because you have what? Nelson's Column, right? Which of course celebrates the triumph of arms at Britain. Now, next time you go to London, please go to Trafalgar Square and see the statue I'm going to describe to you. On one corner, so on each corner, so the Nelson's Column is in the middle, and then each corner there's a statue. There was a statue that was put up shortly after 1858 of a man called Havelock. And I can guarantee you that when tourists go to Trafalgar Square, or even when Britishers, Londoners go to Trafalgar Square, you know, it's a place where people congregate. You meet people there, so forth and so on. You can begin to see there's a different meaning of statues already. People meet there. They go there. You know, you feed the pigeons. All of that. So on one corner is a statue of a man called Havelock. Havelock was a British general who was instrumental in putting down the great rebellion of 1857-58 in India. Okay? Now, when you put up a statue of somebody in Trafalgar Square next to Nelson's Column, this signifies the enormous importance attached to that person. And Havelock in his day was celebrated. He was quickly forgotten, however, when memories of the rebellion faded away. So by 1900, he was almost entirely forgotten, and a pamphlet was published, which was distributed to people who would come to Trafalgar Square. And that pamphlet is called "Who Was Havelock?" Because nobody knew who Havelock was any longer. All right? So they put up the statue. And then the statue essentially loses significance. Okay? Point number one. Number two, when you go to a place like London, most often statues actually have changed meaning. They are signposts. So I was often given directions. I had lived in London for about a year in 1990. 89, 90, and those were the days when, thank goodness, there were no iPhones, no GPS, nothing of that kind, right, to distract you. And either you had one of these maps or the A to Z street guide, as it's called. But you know, if you didn't feel like looking up a map all the time, and so you know, you're in a place and you say, mate, how do I get to there? And typically the answer would be, walk two blocks further up the street. There's a statue there, hang a right at the statue, you'll come to another statue and hang a left at that statue, and then walk another block, and then there's a third statue and take a right at that statue. That was your typical set of directions. Okay? Now you don't have to, you might say that, well, you know, I just happened to get those directions, it happened often. But I want to suggest to you the point I'd made before, now through a different kind of a demonstration. Because what I'm saying to you is that, in fact, actually, we have to rethink completely why we put up these monuments. And of course, there are statues and there are statues. Now, when it's overwhelmingly large, then it may be very difficult to forget it anyhow. Okay, so if you have a Lincoln Memorial, well, that's something on an extraordinarily monumental scale. But I'm talking about, let's say, a statue of this kind. So this is a beautiful statue. A brilliant one, by a woman called Brilliant, Fredda Brilliant. This is in Trafalgar Square. Okay, not sorry, not Trafalgar Square. This is in Mecklenburg Square in London. It was put up in 1969 to mark the 100th anniversary of the birth of Mohandas Gandhi, so the centenary of Mohandas Gandhi, in the heart of London, in the heart of London. Okay, that's important because this was, in a way, a testament by the British to the man who had helped to put down the British Empire. You know, all right. So it's and incidentally, it was right outside this park that about 8 years ago that there was a terrorist bombing, and a fair number of people were killed. So I don't know if anyone here recalls, it was a double-decker bus, one of these red double-decker buses, right outside the square and the park where the statue is. The statue was completely untouched. So there were a few people who were saying this is a sign of God, Gandhi can't be touched, you know, that sort of thing. It was interesting, the public commentary, some of it. And of course, there are statues which are like this one is very refined, as I said, is by a well-known sculptor. And you can see here now a different seated Gandhi. This is in Pushkar. Pushkar is a pilgrimage town in western India. Here you see him with a book. You don't know what book it is, but you can tell from the carving that this is a much rougher piece. This is not as refined as the piece that you saw before. We don't know what book it is. I stand by the statue, and then when people go by, I ask questions. So I do a little ethnography. And a number of people told me that they thought it was a constitution of India. And I told them that, you know what, the constitution of India was drafted after Gandhi died. So I think it's unlikely that it was a constitution, but of course not, because the artist has a liberty to interpret. And you could say that, well, maybe it is a constitution because it shows Gandhi's fidelity to the constitution. It's more likely the Gita, probably the Bhagavad Gita, which was a text that he held to be quite dear. Now, these are relatively what you might describe as innocuous statues. That is, that you can simply say that this is what it signifies, and it's relatively straightforward. But look at this one here, okay? And then we're going to move to a different slate of representations of Gandhi in statues. This is a statue of Gandhi. But can someone tell me, even if you don't know much about India, or nothing about India, really, can you tell me what might be unusual? And some couple of elements that might be unusual. The fact that he's standing with a stick is not unusual, because the walking Gandhi with the stick is very iconic. But what would be the most what's the most prominent thing here in this statue? Yes, Aditya.
I would say glasses, because usually Gandhi has like glasses.
He doesn't have glasses on. Okay, so here if you look at this one, he has glasses. If you look at this one, does he have glasses? No. I wouldn't say that glasses is not because he'd had modern surgery and had them removed. That's not it. There's something else. Yeah.
A feeling that I have is that it's Buddhist style.
That's it. These are the robes of a Buddhist monk. And where is the statue? Nalanda. So, for those of you who don't know, Nalanda is in Bihar. And it is one of the great pilgrimage sites for Buddhists. It is the site of what was the greatest Buddhist monastery. Okay? And so what did they do? They kind of transformed Gandhi into a Buddhist-like figure. Okay? You know, merged the iconography of the Buddha to some extent with the iconography of Gandhi. All right? So you can play around with statues, and this is really quite a. It's not a very refined work. right? You can tell from the way it's done, but it's an interesting work. Okay, so I keep all of this in mind. Now let's move to the next segment of this whole discussion of statues, and this is where then I'm going to begin to try to suggest to you why we have to interpret statues differently. Okay, so here is, so we begin with this one over here. No one here has seen the statue, I'm certain of this. This is a statue of Gandhi in Delhi, in the civil lines area, as it's called. It's a smaller statue, more local. I didn't bring my pointer with me, but the iconography actually of Gandhi is very clear here. I think you can see it at the back there, that, you know, he's got his dhoti. Dhoti is a loincloth. And then you see that wristwatch. I mean, the not the wristwatch, the pocket watch hanging from there. You see the walking stick, the book in the left hand. The book is not always part of the iconography, but that watch and the stick very often are. And now see what's happening there. There's a woman there. And this is where she comes, and she puts down her cooking vessels, and this is her livelihood. She prepares meals, small meals, on the spot, right? And sells the food. So what do you suppose I did? I asked this woman, I said, do you have any idea whose statue this is? She said, no. No idea whatsoever. Now, I am certain that if I told this to a person in the West, they would say, yeah, but you know, people in India aren't that literate. So I will now show you a statue which is in Skokie, and I will explain that, but I'll come to that in a moment. This is more monumental. This is outside the Bombay Legislative Assembly buildings. Okay, Maharashtra State Legislative Assembly buildings. You can see that it's much larger in size, the statue. And it's kind of ironic because the government of Maharashtra, centered in Mumbai, is actually a right-wing government that completely dislikes Gandhi. Really dislike Gandhi. Right? But Gandhi's name carries what I have often described to you before. Cultural capital. That is that even those who dislike him still have to invoke his name. And of course, he's the father of the nation and all of that. And this is a statue of Gandhi in Washington, D.C. There's a very complicated politics, very complicated, because to put up a statue of a foreigner, okay, within the inner circle, as it were, in Washington requires congressional approval. Yes, congressional legislation. It took a very long time to get that congressional legislation and approval and all of that. And this is outside the embassy. All right, this is outside the embassy of India in Washington, D.C., which is near DuPont Circle. Yes. The statue was put up about roughly about 15 years ago. I have the notes on that. Yeah. Okay, and this is the same statue, but you're now seeing it from a different angle, because what you're seeing in the background there is the embassy, and you can see the flag of India there, okay, on the left. All right, so this is outside the... and this here is a statue. All these shots are taken by me, because I've been to all of them. One of the things I do when I go to all of these places is I capture all the Gandhi statues. This is... does anybody recognize by any chance? San Francisco. Okay, so this is San Francisco, the place where you get clam chowder and all of that. You know, the farm, what is it called? The Fisher's Market or whatever, I forget. The Fisherman's Market, not Fisher, Fisherman's Market, something like Fisherman's Wharf, yeah. Right? And he's looking out, as it were. If you take it from this angle, he's looking out onto the bay. And of course, in Porbandar, where he was born, you know, it was looking out to the world, right? But you look at this one here. It's the same statue, so I took this shot. And of course, I took it from this angle and in this particular way, because what I was trying to suggest, there is the you can see that over here. That's the watch that he has. And then you see the clock here. So there's a parallelism there. And then a parallelism between the walking stick and the skyscraper, right? So of course the precise angle which you take it from and how you do it makes a huge difference in how you interpret. the statue. Think of it that way too, right? Because we get a very different representation. If you think of this one and you think of this one, we get very different idea of Gandhi himself, if you continue to interpret. Let me just, I have to finish my train, okay? Now, this is not a statue of Gandhi, at least I hope you don't think it is. Okay, so who is this? Two figures, who might it be? Yeah? Don't hesitate.
Is it Lincoln?
Lincoln? No, it's not Lincoln. And did Lincoln have a buddy that he was always? No. You think of two people together.
Marx and Engels.
Absolutely. Marx and Engels. Now, I'll tell you the story. You see, I'm building up the narrative for you. This is in a park in Shanghai. I took this 7 years ago. What do you suppose is happening here? This person here, do you see what the person is doing? Playing badminton. Okay, with this person over here, you don't see that because the racket is down in her hand. They're playing badminton. So what I did was I spent half an hour here. And I made it a point to speak to younger Chinese because I know that if you are of the younger generation, you know, school going or a little bit older than that, they would all have had to learn English in school for at least a couple of years. The older Chinese, they wouldn't, I don't know Mandarin, I don't know any form of Chinese at all, but younger people, there's a better chance. And I must have asked about 10 people, okay, who gave me a reply, said, whose statue, who is that? I'm pretending like I'm ignorant. I recognized it immediately, but I wanted to know, none of them knew that this was Marx and Engels. And of course now they certainly don't want to know because the only thing China is thinking about is capitalism right now. They're not thinking about Marx and Engels, you know. Now you see what's happening. Think about the implications of this. Because you put up the statue and then of course you normalize it. And that's what I mean when I say that in fact statues are almost guaranteed to make you forget. But even if you don't want to go along with it, we have to think about the ethics of remembering and the ethics of forgetting together. All right? And the narrative is not yet over because statues suffer a certain fate beyond the one that I've described for you. So we have to, since we're talking about Munnabhai, we have to introduce the comic element after all. This is the fate of all statues, whether it's Marx or Jesus Christ or Gandhi, shit falls on your head. Pigeons will sit there and that's what's going to happen. Okay? Undoubtedly. You see the pigeons on this man. This man, no one has ever recognized him. I have asked 100 historians in India, you know, and not one person ever gave me the correct answer. And no one here will. I'm sure of that. Okay? Because when I ask who it is, you know, then I'm told Bhagat Singh or something like that. No, it's not Bhagat Singh.
His mustache.
Huh? Sorry?
He's a mustache.
It's not Chandrasekhar Azad. It's not Chandrasekhar Azad. Were you about to say Chandra? No. It's not Chandrasekhar Azad. It's not Bhagat Singh. It's not Rajguru. It's not Sukhdev. It's someone you haven't heard of. And when I was driving down the Terai is this area in UP, in Uttarakhand, and it's the kind of Jim Corbett territory, tigers. So you drive down Corbett National Park, back towards Delhi, I saw this big sign, Udham Singh Nagar. And the minute I saw the sign, I told the driver, diversion, I want you to go inside. Because if it says Udham Singh Nagar, there has to be a statue of Udham Singh. And lo and behold, as we go into Udham Singh Nagar, the first thing we see is this. This is Udham Singh. Udham Singh was an Indian who swore that he would assassinate the British governor of the Punjab during the 1919 Punjab disturbances. He was a very young boy. And was like Bhagat Singh, was rattled and disturbed by what he saw, and he took a vow that he was going to murder the person who was a then governor of the Punjab, who had approved, in a way, of the massacre. The governor of the Punjab, his term is over, he goes back to England, is leading a life of retirement. In 1941, Udham Singh arrives in London. Sir Michael O'Dwyer, who is the name of the person who would be the governor general, was giving a lecture. There was a public announcement. He knew that in order to get into the building, he had to properly dress up, be suited and booted. He goes there suited and booted with a revolver and point blank shoots him dead. Yes, this is the story of Udham Singh. And there you see the revolver in the right hand. The revolver in the right hand, and they put up a statue. And guess now what happened to the statue? Look at this. Okay, there's a statue, all around it, fruit walas, sabzi walas, fruit, mithai, you know, these little snacks, roadside snacks, oranges, apples, whatever. This is this lot of statues. They change signification. Either you use them to point people to go this direction, go, or it's a place like the banyan tree in India, where people gather under the banyan tree. You gather around the statue. That's what that woman was doing there at the civil line statue. That's the point where she puts down her utensils and she starts preparing meals and starts earning her livelihood. We have to start reading statues differently too. This is, of course, a different kind of critique of Munnabhai now, because there's a kind of a naivety, because Munna and many others think that statues of Gandhi really mean that people are being attentive about Gandhi. No, it means to the contrary, that in fact there is no attentiveness at all. But that's it. I'm giving you a meta level critique, a higher order level critique in a way, because of course at one level it's true that what Gandhi has been reduced to is all these things like statues, putting his name on the buildings, putting his name on currency bills, so forth and so on. Okay, I'm going to finish this segment by giving you another set of pictures and add a different layer of interpretation, which now takes us to a different set of points, which has to do with some problems in the study and interpretation of Gandhi. All right? So this is a statue of Gandhi. Even says that, Mahatma Gandhi. Most statues in India wouldn't say that because it would be understood, although it might be forgotten, or people, as I've shown you before, have no idea. That woman there who didn't know, but she wouldn't be able to read that anyhow, because she's almost certainly illiterate. Almost certainly, you know. So, but in the West, when you put up a statue of Gandhi, you're going to put up a plaque. And on the left is Gordon Brown, the former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. Okay? And on the right is Keith Vaz, an Indian who has long, a person of Indian origin who has long been a member of the British Labour Party. And this statue was put up in Leicester, which has a huge population of Gujaratis. Gandhi was a Gujarati. Huge population of Gujaratis, massive. So actually, when this statue was put up, there was a bit of an objection, because a local football hero, a really famous man, there was no statue of him. So some of the Brits said, "Hey, we're putting a statue of Gandhi when, mate, you know, we don't have a statue of a local football hero. Why Gandhi?" And then the fact that Gandhi is a world historical figure is demonstrated by the fact that the British Prime Minister is there for the inauguration of the statue. You know, I mean, if they put up a statue of Vinay Lal, you don't think the Prime Minister of Great Britain is going to come there to inaugurate that? No. Right? This indicates what his stature is. And this is, now there we get into a next layer of problems. We must become the change we want to see. If there was one Gandhi quote that you see everywhere, in everywhere, okay? I mean, there are at least 50 shops in LA which sell coffee mugs with this inscription on it. and 50 shops that sell t-shirts with this inscription. We must become the change we want to see. Now, and I'm going to tell you what the problem is with that, but let me first show you so that you see that there is a visual evidence for the argument that I'm trying to advance. This is a statue of Gandhi. This I did not take, because I have not been to this place. This is a statue of Gandhi in Wellington, New Zealand, outside the railway station. And that was actually very clever, because why outside the railway station? Because no one traveled on the trains as much as Gandhi did. I don't know that whether they put him up because this was a way to promote rail travel. Hey, if Gandhi traveled by train, all of us can too, you know? All right? But now notice, what do you notice in the plaque? Bottom, we must become the change we want to see. All right? So the same quotation, slight variation, which appears here. And here's the third one. This is in Skokie. You know where Skokie is, anyone? It's outside Chicago. It's a suburb. What is it most famous or notorious for? Every year, the neo-Nazis have their largest meeting in Skokie. In Skokie, in the US. Every year, they meet there annually for the largest annual meeting that they have. It's a And of course, you could say, well, you know, they certainly need a statue of Gandhi in Skokie. Okay, that would be one way to read it, given all the proliferation of the neo-Nazis. Of course, the reason why actually the neo-Nazis meet in Skokie is because many Jewish immigrants after the war settled down there. That's why the neo-Nazis meet there, to terrorize the Jews, you know, right? And they put up the statue of Gandhi over there in Skokie. And this is, so I'll get to you, Anya, in just a moment. So I did that same experiment that I did in Delhi, where I asked this woman and then a number of other people, so this statue, across the street are houses. So I went knocking on doors. And someone opened, and they were about to shut the door, we don't want any salesmen. I said, no, I just have a very simple question. Can you tell me? I have no idea. I'm you know, whose statue this is? And they said, no idea. Bang shut. Three houses, exactly the same thing. No idea. They said, we have no idea who it is. And it's right opposite their home. And the plaque is there, which tells you who it is. Okay? So no one's ever bothered to go and read it. All right? This is my brother on the left and a mutual friend. And here is the, is, you see, so on the pedestal here around it, okay, each, there's a quotation. Every side of it has one quotation. And here, we must become the change we want to see in the world. The same quotation, slight variation. And this is in Evanston. I love this little variation. Because we must become the change. It's like, you know, here the person says, you must be the change. It's like, I don't want to undergo this effort, but you must be the change. Okay? You know, so a slight variation. This is in Evanston, which is not far from Skokie, where Northwestern University is again. And it says Gandhi there, so the person knew where they were, you know, right on the bottom. This is from Africa. Okay, from near a place near Botswana. You must be the change. And he's looking very stern here. He's like, you know, hectoring, lecturing the person. You must be the change you want to see in the world. Okay, now you see what this, you can ignore this one. I'll take a couple of questions. And I'm establishing a number of things here in addition to what I've said. The first thing is, Gandhi never said, we must be the change that we want to see in the world. He never said that. I'm not going to tell you that I've read the 100 volumes of the collected works cover to cover, but you can do a search. And I've read a good deal. And there are other Gandhi scholars who have read. No one has been able to ever locate this in any of Gandhi's writings. However, I am not as I say, a nominalist, by which I mean that simply because Gandhi didn't say it, it doesn't mean that he couldn't have said it. By which I mean that it expresses a sentiment which is very much like the kind of sentiment you would expect from Gandhi. Because Gandhi's view was that the biggest problem with social reformers is they want to change everyone except themselves. Always want to, you know, that's people always want to. It's like interpersonal relations, you know, with your spouse. You always want the other person to change. You know, the problem is always the other person. It's like the French philosopher's definition of hell. I think I told you, didn't I? Or no? Famous French philosopher, his definition of hell, two words, other people. You know. Right? So we must be the change we want to see in the world. One has to change oneself. One has to, if you want to carry out a social experiment where you think, for example, okay, let me carry out a social experiment, organic food. Not before you persuade, or raw food, or unpasteurized milk. Before I test it out on everyone else, let me first test it out on myself. Right? This is, I mean, giving you the most rudimentary example there, but that was always Gandhi's position. But the interesting thing is that this quotation doesn't actually appear in Gandhi's writings. And I want to remind you, look over here. They even put the quotation marks as though it's an exact quote from Gandhi. They put the quotation marks. I mean, whoever did this, you know, they're alert to the fact, this one here doesn't, but in many of the places what you'll see is, look over here at the bottom, quotation marks. You're quoting. Well, where's the text you're quoting from? It isn't there. Right? And of course, this is partly, now we're adding a different element to the story, that this is part of the problem in the interpretation of Gandhi, that Gandhi has simply been reduced to a few formulas. He's been reduced to a few formulas, and Munnabhai is very much about that. Although, of course, I must say that to some extent, Murli or Munna himself is prone to doing that. But then we'll have to see whether it offers a somewhat more expansive conception of Gandhian values and all of that. All right? And so there are some set of issues which have to do with the what we have done today thus far is I've tried to establish for you that there is a rich visual archive. Today you've seen a very different kind of archive than the one I showed 2 weeks ago when we looked at the Nationalist prints. This is a different kind of visual archive. Cinema itself is a visual archive. So there are three visual archives that you've been introduced to when you're looking at Gandhi. You know, the Nationalist prints, cinematic images, and then of course the statues. All right? So, and the statues here have to be seen as a kind of a visual archive. Number two, that our interpretation of statues must be more complex and nuanced, because in fact they may be the very opposite of what they purport to be. All right? That's the claim that I'm suggesting to you. And then I'm suggesting to you that there are certain other kinds of problems in the interpretation. And one of those problems, for example, is how Gandhi has now been reduced to a set of formulas. And one of the principal formulas is precisely this quotation that is attributed to him that you see here. And of course, then there are other questions, larger philosophical questions as well, which I have raised as an aside. For example, what is the ethics of remembering and the ethics of forgetting? That sometimes, perhaps, certain forms of forgetting are just as important. Because if we actually did forget certain kinds of things, they may be useful for remembering things that are more important. You could take a very crass, instrumental kind of view of that sort. You could take a more complex view, and that complex view would have to do with the fact that there is always a problem. And here I'm using an insight from an essay by Ernest Renan, R-E-N-A-N, is a French scholar was most well known for his biography of Christ, of Jesus, sort of a historical interpretation of Christ. But he wrote an essay, an extremely influential essay, which I had thought about including in the syllabus, but it would have taken us really far astray into European history. The essay is called, What is a Nation? And we started this course with that, because I don't know how many of you now recall, I said to you, okay, so what is a nation? You know, and we had a discussion where some people said, well, maybe people who share a certain language or a certain religion. And then I said, well, yeah, but we can put a cross next to each of them, because then we can see that none of these really hold. That's what Renan was trying to do. He was trying to understand what is a nation. But in that essay, he makes one extraordinary argument. And that argument is that an act of forgetting is actually critical to the making of a nation. There are some things that we have to forget in order to constitute ourselves into a nation. Right? So that's what I'm calling the ethics of forgetting. And Munnabhai is a much more simplified sort of analysis of this whole dialectic of remembering and forgetting. Because remember that Murli or Munna is always saying that, you know, we've forgotten Gandhi's values. Right? And yet we have all these aids to remembering. But that is precisely maybe why we've forgotten, because we've normalized these aids, putting Gandhi on every currency note, putting thousands of statues of Gandhi around the country, putting his name on every building, every major building, having a major road named after him. That this form of normalization maybe another way of forgetting, in fact, you know, right? So this is one way for you to understand both the larger visual archive to which cinema is related, of course, and then some larger problems in the interpretation of Gandhi. And because Gandhi is a world historical figure, therefore, as I've attempted to do today, it is perfectly apt to take these images from elsewhere, from outside India as well, many of them within India, many outside India, to show that there are similar kinds of problems. And that we shouldn't think that because the literacy levels are much higher in the US, so therefore these statues, for example, work in a very different way, not necessarily, than they do in India. And that's why, you know, that little experiment in Skokie shows precisely this, that there are actually problems in the interpretation of statues, because there are people who choose to actually think of them very differently. That they are not the kinds of aids that we think they are. Their signification has actually fundamentally changed. Okay, so Anya, I think you wanted to ask something.
Oh, it's just about the statue that you showed a while ago, I think in Skokie.
Skokie, yes. Yes. I doubt the neo-Nazis even know who Gandhi is. I mean, if he looked a little more Jewish, maybe they might have vandalized it, but he certainly doesn't look Jewish enough, if I may put it this way. No. I mean, for all I know, last few years it might have been. I haven't Googled to see or anything, but no. No, I mean, it's been around actually for about, I'd say 20 years at least. I mean, this set of images that I took, this dates back to at least 10 years ago, at least 10 years ago. And I first saw it several years before that, you know. So the statue has been there for at least 20 years, I would say, you know. Aditya?
Yeah, so actually another question. So I understand that there are some historical figures that have been reduced to certain formulas that you were talking about, but I still sort of fail to understand how statues sort of make you forget. Just to give you an example, so you were talking about China.
Yeah.
And Mark and Engels were there, and
yeah,
people didn't know who they were. Same with Skokie, they
yeah,
knew who Gandhi was. But I personally feel that, regardless of whether the statue was there or not there, I don't think these people would have known the first place. I don't think these statues are sort of making them forget them. In fact, like the Udham Singh example,
yeah,
like if the Udham Singh statue wasn't there,
yeah,
you would never have gone there. You would never have taken the picture,
yeah,
right? And I wouldn't have seen it.
Yeah.
And like that's the first thing. Like now I'm learning about Udham Singh
because yeah,
of that statue.
Oh, but I could have taught you about Udham Singh through something completely different.
Yeah, but I mean, I just don't yeah. feel that they're sort of making you forget. Like, those statues are responsible for making you forget.
No. You see, this is not, we're not, there's no relationship of causality here. In other words, it's not as though the statue, okay, is necessarily intended to make you forget. Which, and you might say that, well, look, this is how I read you, which would be a fair criticism, if indeed that was what was conveyed. What I'm suggesting to you is that if you're looking at the effects of this, okay, what is transparent is that this is actually intrinsic to the nature of a statue. So I'm making actually even a more radical claim, in a sense, than what you might be attributing to me. I'm saying this is in fact intrinsic to the meaning of a statue itself. All right, and I don't think it would be sufficient to say that, look, there may be so and so who actually sees it differently. Well, of course, but that would be the case with if I said to you that a particular work is, there are certain qualities that are intrinsic to it, but then you see qualities that are completely different. Well, that's fine. Okay? So, but we would have to, and that's why I'm giving you a multitude of examples from different settings, from very different settings. And let's supposing for a moment that you said, well, look, how do I know that you haven't made it up? Okay? You could play the skeptic. That would be perfectly acceptable too, to me. You might say that, look, I mean, you're saying that you talk to these people, okay, how do I know that you're... But look at how the social space, okay, so don't go by what I'm saying now. Look at the social space around the statue. What's happened? It's become a badminton court. What's happened in Udham Singh Nagar? It has become a fruit market. Would you agree with that or not? Right? The social space has changed. When the social space has changed, we have to understand the social signification has changed. What it suggests and what it means, that also has fundamentally altered. I don't need to give you actually a textual spoken narrative at all. If I showed you 100 such images, we would be able to come to exactly the same conclusion. That the social space signified by the statue has changed. You see, the social space of a swimming pool does not change. Yes, there it can be modified to a very limited extent when people do pool parties where they hardly ever swim at all, but they do a pool party. That would be a good illustration of where it's actually the social space has changed. Right? Although, even in those situations, somebody will still dive in for a couple of minutes, and you know, it's like the films that you see, they dive in for a minute and then they lounge around and, you know, do wicked things after that, you know, by the pool, you know, which I won't specify right now, right? Okay, so, but it's a body of water and there's only so much you can do to change that social space. With the statues, you can't. The woman who's cooking, why the statue? Because it's always, you see, it's a landmark. If she has to tell the bus driver, "Arey, aake zara khana kha le, come and have a meal," you know, "Tu kahan baithti hai? Where do you sit?" "Murti ke niche." Where do you sit? Under the statue. You see how that's what I mean. So this is what I'm trying to suggest to you. And of course, actually, the interesting thing is that Munnabhai, the film, because let's not forget this is in the context of the film too. In Munnabhai, there is actually a very naive kind of reading, and that's of statues, because there the claim actually is contrary to the claim that I'm making. You know, the claim is that, oh, I'm only remembered through my statues and through the fact that I'm on the banknotes, so to speak. Okay? And through my having my names in the buildings, and so Bapu says to Munna, you know, remove my name from all of these. Mera naam hata do, in sabse. Right? But in fact, actually, all of those have had the effect of making him a forgotten figure, fundamentally. So I'm doing a meta-level reading there, a different order, because at some plain level, what's going on there, at some rudimentary level, it's clear, the meaning, to an average viewer. But then you can do a different, better reading. And I'm not going to expect you to be able to do those kinds of readings necessarily when I give you questions, because that would require, I think, a bit more experience with these kinds of materials and with texts and so on. Is that? I know you're not entirely satisfied, which would be fine.
I get the idea.
Yeah, okay. All right. So we will terminate this. I could give you we could go on for this forever, really have to move on to the film. Okay. Now I want to look at some aspects of the film as well. All right. And these are scenes that some of them I've discussed in passing. Some I haven't mentioned at all, but I just want to give you a little bit more sense of how to play around with some of the ideas, okay? But before we get into that, let me just reiterate a couple of things at this juncture. The first is, and I have mentioned this repeatedly, but given the kind of film that we have, it's important to reiterate it, namely that, look, this is not a film which will delve into a conventional history of nationalism and Gandhi's role in that. So you're not going to see the Quit India movement or the Salt March various of the other kinds of political initiatives and movements which were associated with Gandhi. All right, you're not going to see that at all in this film. So this is not that kind of conventional narrative. The legend of Bhagat Singh is more of that kind of, you know, so story of Bhagat Singh and his political life and so on and so forth. You know, to do that, you have to see, for example, the 1982 film, which is not actually an Indian film, really. It's a co-production, the famous film called Gandhi, made by Richard Attenborough, which was released in late 1982. A lot of difficulties with that film that the sophisticated critics have. Because it's a hagiography and all of that, you know, shows the life of a saint, all of that. But in any, we're not looking at that film, and it's not really part of the Bollywood mainstream, because this is really a course on mainstream Indian cinema and how it has delved into the whole issue of nationalism. And Munnabhai is very much part of the mainstream of commercial Indian cinema. All right, so you have to keep that in mind. And secondly, you have to keep in mind what I have described to you today, and I had talked about that before as well. In passing, I've talked about it on a number of occasions, and those are what I'm describing now as problems in the interpretation of Gandhi and problems in the interpretation of Indian nationalism more broadly. All right, and I want to give you one very good illustration of that before we move on to the film. And this is drawn from a reading that I did not assign to you, but is in fact actually a reading that has been exceedingly important in initiating a different way of studying Indian history. So this was a piece written about 30, 35 years ago, and it's called Gandhi as Mahatma. That's the exact title of the piece. The person who wrote it is an Indian historian, now retired from the University of Delhi, from the history department. His name is Shahid Amin. Okay, Gandhi as Mahatma. Now, what he was attempting to do there was to say that, look, I mean, there is this kind of authorized view of Gandhi. The authorized view means the official view, the official Indian view, where, so that is looking at Gandhi from the top, as it were. And this official or authorized view of Gandhi insists on looking at him as the great leader of the Congress Party, the great renouncer, the apostle of truth, the prophet of nonviolence, all of that, right? Heroic figure. And a life such as Gandhi's lent itself to this kind of epic narrative. right? Because it was a very long, rich life, cut short, of course, by the assassination of Gandhi, which you see here in the middle. So this is, by the way, this print I did not show you, okay? But I want to show it to you in the context of what I'm speaking right now, because in India, the question arises, in Gandhi's own lifetime, how did people learn about Gandhi? What were the ways in which people came to know about Gandhi? In 1920, there was no radio. 1930, there was no radio. Yes, you had print, nationalism, you had newspapers. Significant portion of the population, significant is actually understated, preponderant portion of the population of India was illiterate in 1930. Completely illiterate. Well, how would they have known? Yes, we can imagine rumors, word of mouth, those were some of the ways. Prints were another way. Prints. You know, so you print 100,000 copies of these and you pass them around. We don't know exactly how these prints, so for those of you who were here for that makeup class, I showed you quite a few prints. You know, we don't know how these prints were circulated. How were they actually put up on walls? You know, so forth and so on. But this would have been one way. This is a single print, and it gives the whole life story of Gandhi. The whole life story of Gandhi, as it were, the whole life story. Okay, and this is of obviously 1948 after the assassination, because right in the middle of this print, what you see is the stigma, the blood over here where the cursor is, right? These are the blood drops when he was shot dead. So you know that this is post 30th January 1948. Sometimes the prints have a date, sometimes they don't, you know. This one does not have a date over here, okay? But it does say MM is for Mohandas Gandhi Jeevani. Jeevani is life history. All right? So you have to, what do you do? You begin here. This is, he's in the cradle. So you go up there all the way, then you go to the right, then you come down to the, come down from there, top down here, and then you go this way and up here in the middle. That's how you read the print. So, you know, he's in the cradle, young boy, all right, this is, you know, he is just starting his career in England, and then becomes a barrister in South Africa, right? Okay, over there. And notice, by the way, he's dressed formally, coat, tie, all of that, okay? Right? And this is, keep in mind that quip that I mentioned to you. I don't know if I mentioned it to you. I think I did. But I have this quip about Gandhi that I've talked about quite often. The only adult person I know who began his adult life vastly overdressed and ended it vastly underdressed. You know, and you could write the whole biography of Gandhi through that frame. Okay, this is a sartorial print, by which I mean what he's wearing at what point in his life tells you everything. Okay, and then on the top there, you notice he's got the stick. He's a Satyagrahi. He's now the founder of the movement of Satyagraha. He's a Satyagrahi. He's got a satchel, a bag. This is last year's in South Africa. Then he comes back to India there with his wife Kasturba. He's wearing a turban. Very common for someone like him to wear a turban at that point. And then now you notice that to the right of that, you see that he has now in a loincloth. So he's shifted to a loincloth, which he adopted in Madurai, and a shawl spread over his shoulders. And then the salt march, extreme right top. Then he has tea with the King Emperor. And this is where Gandhi was, you know, he had actually gone to have tea at Buckingham Palace. You know, tea at Buckingham Palace. And when he went in slippers and a loincloth and a shawl. This one actually shows a little bit more modestly, because very often the shawl would leave some of his chest barren. And a reporter said, "Mr. Gandhi, do you propose going to see the King Emperor?" dressed in this way. And he said, I dare say the King Emperor is wearing enough for both of us. You know? Okay? That was Mohandas Gandhi. All right? And now you can see, bare-chested, which is how he appeared in a majority of photographs, you know? I once had a feminist who complained to me. She said, only men can do that, you know? Said, you know, but we have to try to understand the politics of what he's doing here, you know? And then here, Gandhi addressing crowds, all of that. This is with Nehru. This is with Rajaji and a small boy. This is his two walking sticks, as they were called, Abba and Manu. Long stories for all of them. I mean, long, long stories. And then here we are in the middle, you know, larger than life. At the time of his death, notice how big he is here in comparison to large. It's fantastic, the print. Because it just shows you how you would get. And that's what Munnabhai is about. How do you get the message across? How do you get the message across? So now let's go back to this. And you'll understand the context here. Because what Shahid Amin was saying is that there is an authorized version of Gandhi. The official version. The version from the top. Great leader, great saint, etc., etc., etc. But for him the fundamental question was, how do common people understand Gandhi? What do they know of him? How do they know what they know about him? And how is his name used? Right, so what he did was he looked at a place called Gorakhpur, early 1920s, where Gandhi had arrived to give a speech. Early 1920s, he was now basically known all over India, because he had just been anointed, as it were, informally, the leader of the independence movement. Okay, but Shahid's questions are pertinent. Well, what did people know about Gandhi at this point in time, and what did they understand by his teachings? Okay, so in other words, let's put it in much simpler terms. He's trying to show what Gandhi looks like from the bottom up. What is history from below? For those of you who are history majors, you ever hear the phrase history from below. This is what we're talking about. There are layers of sophistication that I'm not going to enter into right now. What are the precise theoretical strategies that he uses to read? So what does he do? He looks at the local newspapers, Shahid Amin, to see how Gandhi's arrival in this village is going to be reported, because people have been told that Gandhi is going to arrive in a few days. So the newspapers are starting to publish accounts in the anticipation of his arrival. It's like the anticipation of the now aborted June 12th nuclear summit. You know, you start hearing about it before, right? Okay. So he starts looking at these newspaper accounts. What he finds staggers the imagination. Because what he finds is that actually Gandhi's name is like a floating signifier. By which I mean that, you see, names and things signify in various ways, right? But it's a floating signifier. It means that it's like an empty vessel into which you put whatever you want. Now, let me explain. Okay, what I mean by all of this. He found that, for example, there's a village, because he's going to arrive in Gorakhpur district. Gorakhpur is a district, so there are lots of villages there. So he finds in a particular village, he's reading this in the newspapers, I published at that time. He finds in a particular village, he finds that, let's say there are 500 people living in the village, and 30 of them say, we're not followers of the Mahatma. We think this whole emphasis on Ahimsa is bogus. This is a ruse. You know, this is not going to lead us to independence. And we don't agree with some of the Mahatma's teachings. So what are some of the teachings that they don't agree with? For example, they don't agree with Gandhi's whole insistence on prohibition. Gandhi was a big advocate of prohibition, right? No liquor. And these guys, they say, yeah, you know, our evenings, that's what we do in the village. There's nothing else to do, you know. Right? And we don't agree with that. And then now in this village, the ones who are great advocates of Gandhi's ideas already, or they claim to be followers, they're trying to tell these 30 people, okay, you should listen to what the Mahatma says, right? And they say, no, we're not interested. So then these rumors are, some of the people tell these people who are outliers now, because they don't want to go along with Gandhi, some of them are told, if you don't agree to accept Mahatma's teachings, shit will fall on your head. Literally. By the way, I'm not using it metaphorically. Shit will fall on your head, literally. Or you wake up in the morning and your eyelids will be stuck and you won't be able to open them. And then what happens? The newspaper reports the following day, 3 people woke up in the morning and couldn't open their eyelids. And then they believe, because, a miracle. Gandhi is divine. He created a miracle. But in some instances, there's violence. So people don't agree. So what happens? In the middle of the night, 2 people come and they burn this person's hut. But they're doing it in the name of Gandhi. I mean, see, this is the irony, right? That Gandhi is the great advocate of ahimsa, of non-violence. And now, to persuade others to believe in Gandhi, people are actually committing violence. Right? This is the world he explores. And this is what is meant when I speak about Gandhi, Mahatma, as a floating signifier, because what he's saying here is, well, actually, you know, there were even people who believed in violence and who claimed to be acting in the name of Gandhi. This is what it means to say that Gandhi is like an empty vessel and you put whatever you want into it. So the fundamental submission there is, and he gives lots of examples, so I'm not going to go over all of them. The fundamental submission is that there is this authorized version, and then we have to think about how the name of Gandhi was received at the lowest rungs of Indian society, among the working classes, among the peasants. How was Gandhi's name deployed? How were his teachings transmitted? How were they, in many cases, actually twisted and turned to mean something entirely different? So forth and so on. This is very different than the version of Gandhi you get from the top. But notice that in all of this, and this is the realm of Munnabhai, again, in all of this, we are not speaking about a kind of a nationalism of the sort that we think about conventionally when we think about political movements. What we're really thinking about is what you might call values, or certain kinds of ideas and concepts that Gandhi stood for, and how are they received. And this is really fundamentally what Munnabhai is seeking to do, is to open up that world. We'll just take 5 minutes and finish up, because I do want to show you couple of clips from the film. Very, very, very short clips, incidentally, just a couple of, most of them are 10, 15 seconds. Okay, now we have the same problem again. I'm going to have to figure this out. 1 minute. Okay. Yes. Good. Okay. So the first one is, so this film introduced a new term. Okay. And that's why I want to show you this particular clip here. So you remember that, do you remember this scene that I'm about to show you? This young man who has spent 700,000 rupees of his father's, you know, hard-earned money to gamble on the stock market, okay? And then he loses all of that money, and then now Munna is going to advise him that you should be candid. You know, the Hindi film loves this kind of sort of tear-producing, you know, heart-wrenching scene, which is what you're going to get, you know. I'm just about to get there. So, by the way, you saw the framed Gandhi there again. I have talked about the framed Gandhi. And, you know, Gandhi was a lawyer. So, there's a double entendre going on here. But Gandhigiri. Okay? So, that's the term that this film introduced. Gandhigiri. Okay? So, Gandhi. So, in order to understand that, I have to first give you the opposite, okay? And so, you know, in Hindi, you have these young men who are sort of floating population. They're called gundas, often. So gundas are these hooligans, small-time thugs, most of them. And troublemakers. So they'll stand on the street, loiter, tease young women, maybe engage in, you know, some sexual, innuendos, maybe a little bit harassment, sometimes some assault. Generally troublemakers, gundas. And they also play the big man, the boss. So the word that is used in Hindi, this is word used for people who engage in bullying. It's called Dadagiri. Dadagiri. Dadagiri means sort of like, Dadagiri kar raha. You know, someone is sort of bossing people around, acting like the big man, big shot. That's, you say, Dadagiri kar raha. So the new term that is introduced here is, and this film actually introduced it, is Gandhigiri. Okay, so Gandhigiri, because he says that what I'm going to engage in now is Gandhigiri. That is that instead of bullying people, I'm going to engage a kind of acts of Gandhian Satyagraha, Gandhianness. It's impossible to translate the term actually into English, but this is what he had just said. I'm going to engage in Gandhigiri, and then you get that touch, that sort of 2-3 minute scene. Everyone's weeping. The whole radio, because this young man is then going to go to his father. So this is, by the way, straight out of Gandhi's autobiography in a way. You see, that's the other interesting thing. Because what had Gandhi done as a young man? He stole money. Okay, and I spoke to you about this last time. He stole money from his father. Then he starts to feel guilty. Then he writes this love letter to his father, if I may put it this way, you know, repenting and all of that. And then, you know, his father reads a note. He summons him. And then they both have a good cry, you know, and okay, now it's, you know, I'm never going to do this again, right? That's what we're really speaking about here, okay? And then, so I showed you that the Gandhigiri, where the term is, and then the scene that I'd mentioned to you, but this is the scene, 129, 51 second here. So this is the... this is the Deewaar scene. Tere paas kya hai? Hai Bapu. See, this is Deewaar. This is where it's inspired from. And you know what happens is when you make interpretations like that, then the empiricist will always come forward and say, Professor Lal, how can you prove it? You know, have you talked to the director of the film? No, I haven't talked to the director of the film. You know, but why do you need to talk to the director of the film? You know, this is what it means to say, hey, you know, this is how films actually borrow from each other, as literary works do, right? And frankly, I don't care whether actually the filmmaker even was thinking about Deewaar. The thing is, the audience will, because they understand that that's the template for this, you know. So this is a very interesting illustration of how commercial Indian cinema partakes of some kind of available set of ideas that we have. All right, and then last scene that I want to show you, because this is a very good demonstration of what I've been trying to suggest. We'll just continue with this one, and you'll see that Gandhian nationalism and the narrative about Gandhi is not really fundamentally in the long run about this kind of political nationalism, you know, the march to the sea, quit India movement. I mean, 150 years from now, that's not what's going to really remain, if anything remains of Gandhi. It's going to be precisely the kind of ideas that he stood for, the notions of satya, ahimsa, and of course more fundamental things which I can't get into because that would take us to a very different plane altogether. For example, his whole critique of modern industrial civilization and all of that, you know, right? Okay, but here, let's just watch one and a half minutes of this. Mast aadmi aaya tha. You know, this is again, so some people objected. Because mast aadmi, mast means someone who's masti kar raha hai, mast is someone who's kind of, you know, cool. Like the English translation is not bad here, cool dude, you know. But to sort of reduce this man to a cool dude seemed to the old style Gandhians a little bit too much, you know, a little too liberal here in their outlook, right? That was the supposition. And of course, the defenders say that, well, yeah, how do you make Gandhi, quote, relevant to the youngsters? You know, you have to show him as a kind of a cool dude. And I think that that's a problem too, that kind of way of trying to read Gandhi. Gandhigiri. Okay. Okay. All right. So we and this is where we get into the scene that we're talking. Okay. So we'll stop over here, and let me remind you that next week we have a lecture only on Tuesday. There's no class on Thursday. And for Tuesday, we're going to do the news.